at a time debate on as to what direction the Congress party may take, whether Rahul Gandhi's leadership is effective, what our country's politics may look like in 2024 after the next elections, whether Modi is now the most dominant factor in Indian politics, comes a fascinating, riveting new book. For anyone who is interested in politics, whether you are in politics, in journalism, or just a citizen who is interested in both the history, the present, and the future of our country, the book in my hand is a book that takes you inside the explosive, very detailed diaries of Congress veteran and former president Pranab Mukherjee. And these diaries have been painstakingly chronicled by her daughter, by his daughter, I beg your pardon, Sharmistha Mukherkee. And in fact, the book is called Pranab, My Father. And Sharmistha, it is a pleasure to have you here with us.
Thank you.
And the book is fascinating. And I remember from being a young reporter, I would sometimes interview Dada and he would talk to me about these diaries. And I would keep telling him ki ek din some journalist would love to get her hands on these diaries. Well, his daughter has done that for us. Let me start by asking you to talk a little bit about what everybody's talking about. A very scathing appraisal of Rahul Gandhi comes through in Pranab Das' diaries. And in fact, towards the end of the book is one of his last diary entries before he dies. And the words he uses for the Gandhi family, he says that it is the worst sort of hegemony. He even questions himself, am I in some ways, am I among those who is responsible? Was my blind loyalty responsible? Should I have questioned this culture earlier? A culture that allowed, he says, five family members to occupy the top post in the party for 37 years. Again, I repeat the phrase, worst sort of hegemony. When you read that diary entry, and obviously you read it after he died, talk a little bit about that entry.
Well, it is obviously that, you know, he was deeply concerned about the future of Congress. Even earlier also, he has written that, you know, I cannot believe in Congress Mukt Bharat. Congress is a movement that established democracy in the country. So he was deeply disturbed about post-2014 scenario, that what is happening. And to me, very honestly, because that time I had just joined politics, I was fully involved with Congress. He never mentioned anything to me in terms of conversation other than making some stray comments. So everything about his thoughts of Congress, about the current situation, I came to know after he passed away. Mm-hmm. And whenever I asked him about the prospect of Congress, the future, he would always say that, you know, Congress has to survive and it will. Mm-hmm. And once he got very irritated with me and he said, just concentrate on the job, what the party has assigned to you, mm-hmm. you know, the task of reviving Congress is not yours. Leave it to the senior president, the senior leaders of the party and the Congress president. So it's only after his passing away that when I read about his, you know, diary entries. There is one very interesting entry I find. It was somewhere in 1970s. I don't exactly remember the year because I don't have the memory of my father. So it was an AICC session at Chandigarh during Indira Gandhi's time. So he wrote that it's surprising that there is no voice of dissent in the session. And he went on to go on writing, saying that Congress always, you know, gave platform to different voices. And that is one of the reasons that, you know, Congress, no other national party could emerge. He's talking about 1970s, 1971.
But clearly that Congress was lost along the years.
Yes, and that is a time also he questioned that, you know, I don't understand the reason for it. And I don't know whether it's going to be good for democracy. Mm. So, and we have seen that, you know, as you are saying, that Congress has been lost for years and it did not happen in one day. It has happened over.
I think of this veteran congressman. Just months before he dies.
Just about a month ago.
I think the last diary entry we have is 28th July 2020. Mm-hmm. And he's disillusioned with the state of the party. He's disillusioned in particular with the leadership.
He's disturbed. He's very, very disturbed. He was very, very disturbed. And somewhere he also blamed himself for this, himself and others like him. And he questioned, you know, that whether the blind loyalty of him first to Indira Gandhi and to later to Sonia Gandhi, whereas the blind loyalty of people of him and people like him are responsible for stopping the democratic process of electing leaders in the party. So he was definitely very disturbed.
Now this book, and again, the book is in my hand. Please do read it, Pranab, my father. It takes you inside these explosive diaries. One of the diary entries, and this is not in 2020, this is earlier, and more than one, is about Rahul Gandhi. And he's clearly not a fan. He, in particular, is livid after the infamous episode where Rahul Gandhi basically lashes out at an ordinance passed by his own government, which is designed to, of course, give a free pass to Lalu Prasad Yadav. You write very interestingly in the book that your father was, in principle, also opposed to the ordinance. But when Rahul Gandhi, while Dr. Manmohan Singh was abroad, made a public display of his disagreement, your father, you write, was more angry than you had ever seen him before. You also say that he said, "Who does he think he is?" And you said that Rahul Gandhi has put the final nail in the Congress coffin with this. Talk about that time.
Yes, it was actually, you know, I happened to be the one who broke the news of Rahul Gandhi trashing the ordinance.
To him?
To him. And he was livid. You know, his face became red and he started shouting that, you know, exactly who does he think he is? And he's not a member of cabinet. Mm. And not being a member of cabinet, how can he trash a decision of the government, of his own government, publicly like this? And so at night, you know, of course, which I came to know about it later on, I read about it. On that same night, you know, he wrote that this boy has got all the arrogance of Gandhi Nehru lineage
without their
political acumen.
I remember reading
and
that.
Later, after 2014, you know, after the election results were declared and, you know, we were one day discussing about in general. So he said that, you know, like Rahul Gandhi's this trashing the ordinance is perhaps one of the final nails in the coffin for Congress. And he, I mean, that time I was in politics. And he said, you know, if you're vice president, Rahul Gandhi was then the vice president when the ordinance incident happened. He said, if you're vice president of your own party, trashes publicly his own government, you know, why should people vote for you?
Yeah. But, you know, I think of this sentence has all the arrogance of the Nehru-Gandhi family without their political acumen. That's a pretty scathing appraisal. You were in politics then. Did you agree with it? Today you're out of politics. You can speak honestly.
You know, without having the arrogance and without, you know, my father would really be able to, would have been able to comment on this. I mean, in his own interaction with Indira Gandhi, I mean, definitely, I don't think, you know, Indira Gandhi showed him arrogance.
Yeah.
In his own interaction with Rajiv Gandhi or Sonia Gandhi, I don't think, you know, Sonia Gandhi would definitely, you know, I read many incidents where there was, you know, heated exchange of fire, quote unquote, you know.
Yeah.
So I don't think they behaved arrogantly towards them, but I guess it is a natural human tendency that of, you know, being in power for so long, you know, if it's concentrated within, and as he rightly said,
worst kind of hegemony.
In 37 years, if, you know, five members are from the same family, a Congress president, and three of them were the prime minister, obviously some degree of arrogance tend to be there. But he also, I mean, you know, writes that the Gandhi family members, I mean, they have also displayed very strong political acumen. So his problem with Rahul was that, you know, he might be having all the arrogance, but he lacked the acumen.
Yeah, I think that has to be there are many quotable quotes in Pranab Das diaries and in your book, but that has to be in some ways the quotable quote of the book, that he had all the arrogance of his family without the political acumen. Now, the book goes on to describe different moments where Rahul Gandhi does come to meet Pranab Da, you know, different moments in the course of his career and in Pranab Da's life. And there's one sentence that stood out. He's yet to mature politically.
Yeah. You know, that was, I think, to be very honest, in Baba's diaries, I did not find too many references of Rahul Gandhi. maybe there might be about 5, 6, 7, 8 maximum. One of the earliest reference of significance, what I found, it was somewhere at the end of UPA 1. And I think it was a strategy meeting for the elections. Mm. For the elections, and Rahul seemed to be quite against coalition. So Baba wrote in his diary that I told him to put forward his argument more clearly, more elaborate on it, and to put it more logically. And he said that he will come and meet him. And after that, a few references of him, Rahul coming and meeting my father at his official residence. And these few meetings, not very, but meetings continued also when he became president. Mm. So there are a couple of observations. Initially, you know, my father seemed to be quite okay with him. And whenever Rahul made a good speech in the parliament, you know, he praised him.
He praised his land acquisition.
Yeah. And but I think there was a shift after this ordinance issue. And post 2014, you know, there is an interesting observation that, you know, Rahul came and said the way Rahul, you know, gave his analysis about the election with a lot of detachment. So that is what my father found it a bit surprising, that, you know, he was talking as an outsider, as if he was not the face of the campaign.
I remember the exact line, in fact, from the diary. Your father writes that Rahul Gandhi, the distance that he put between himself and the campaign, as if he had nothing to do with it, as if he was not the face of the campaign. Exactly. That was one observation. And the other was lacking the killer instinct.
Yes, absolutely right. And which also he wrote, in contrast, probably the BJP workers, you know, got that, you know, from Narendra Modi, you know.
Yeah.
So lack of killer instinct, definitely. And also then he was very disappointed when, you know, with Rahul's frequent disappearing acts post 2014. And he felt that, you know, at a crucial moment, you know, he can't just go on.
Listening to all this and say some things never change. The debate around Rahul Gandhi never changes. It's like every election we have the same debate. And then comes this book, which is really an insider's, you know, view and the view of a man who is widely regarded as perhaps the most astute politician of our time. So I think what he's saying is going to be taken very seriously. I want to ask you to talk a little bit about whether you and he would get into disagreements over Rahul Gandhi, because, you know, look at the things that have been mentioned, that the Nehru-Gandhi family had a hegemony over the party, that Rahul Gandhi was not politically mature, that Rahul Gandhi acted as if he was not responsible for his own party's defeat, that he lacked the killer instinct, and that when the ordinance issue happened, for Pranab Da, it was the last nail in the Congress coffin. Did you feel as angry as he did? But you couldn't show it.
You know, by that time, you know, I was quite involved in Congress politics.
Yeah.
I was quite involved. And, you know, because my experience is also very less. So, I mean, 2014 also, I was not that. I became very active for 2015. Mm. So, obviously, I was pretty shocked, you know, looking at 44, which was... but I was like, oh, enthusiasm, the beginner's enthusiasm.
Yeah.
And my father really never talked to me about it, because obviously he didn't want to dishearten me or whatever.
And it's important to remember that you've read the diaries after he's died.
After he died. He passed away.
That's right.
So and whenever I asked him about Congress, how Congress is going to revive, and one day he really snapped at me that this is not your responsibility. You know, you just concentrate on the task assigned to you by the party.
Yeah.
And he would always say that Congress will revive. So he never talked to me about, you know, Rahul Gandhi or about... only once I remember, just before 2019 elections. Mm. So I asked him, you know, that how Congress is going to fare and all. So he said that if Congress reaches 88, I am going to consider emergence of Rahul Gandhi as leader. Mm. Why 88? I don't know. Perhaps, you know, doubling the number. You know, and I got very angry with him. I said, what are you saying? Yeah. You know, I mean, we are going to definitely, you know, give a very tough fight. And, you know, we are going to be around 130, 40 or something. He did not say anything. Mm. You know, he did not say anything. But now when I look back, you know, that was, you know, one statement which kind of remains stuck in my head.
But, you know, at a time when the Congress has just, you know, lost really badly in the assembly elections, these are very, very, very timely observations that are emerging years after they were first chronicled in these diaries. And Of course, you do say that if Dada had been alive, he would have been impressed with Rahul Gandhi's Bharat Jodo Yatra. But the essential appraisal of Mr. Gandhi seems to be that of a non-serious politician, that of a non-skilled politician, a politician without acumen. And I'm only quoting from his diaries.
Yes. You know, I wrote that, you know, if had Baba been alive, he would have been definitely been impressed with Bharat Jodo, because I personally feel that Bharat Jodo created a very, very positive impact. But unfortunately, had he been alive now, he would have been very disappointed again that on the first anniversary of Bharat Jodo Yatra, Rahul was abroad. That, you know, nothing was done to take forward the spirit of Bharat Jodo Yatra. Yeah. I mean, they could have done, I mean, they should have, you know, one can't think that, you know, you do one big event two years before the national elections and the impact of it is going to be felt after 2 years. It doesn't happen like that. Politics is an ever-changing thing. So,
yeah. And on a lighter note, but on a telling note, there's a story of how Rahul Gandhi was to meet Pranab Da. And his office had to set up an appointment. And then you tell us the rest of the story.
Well, there was this very interesting incident that Rahul came to meet my father around, I think, 8 o'clock in the morning. And when he was taking his walks at the Mughal Garden, and he really used to get disturbed if somebody, you know, kind of interferes. So anyway, he met him. And as it turned out, that Rahul was supposed to meet him in the evening.
At 8 p.m. But he showed up at 8 a.m. To meet the President of India, no less.
yes. And it seems Rahul's office misinformed him about the time. So I came to know about the incident from one of the ADCs. So when I asked my father, obviously he was not amused, because you know him. So he was very particular about these kind of things. And so very sarcastically, he commented that if Rahul's office can't differentiate between AM and PM, how do they hope to run PMO one day?
and like I said, it's on a lighter note, but it's a telling story. Now, before we move to other parts of the book, your father is conferred with the Bharat Ratna and the Gandhi family does not attend, because the Bharat Ratna is conferred by the Modi government, but it is actually the Indian state that is conferring the Bharat Ratna. You ask Dada about this, and he says, it's in the book, but he says...
Yes, he said that what's the big deal? They did not allow P.V. Narasimha Rao, a former Prime Minister, Congress Prime Minister, and the former Congress President, they did not allow his body, his mortal remains, to enter AICC. So what's the big deal that they haven't attended the Bharat Ratna ceremony?
But as a daughter, were you surprised that, you know, I know there was a tweet later congratulating Pranab Da, but did you feel that there should have been grace enough to at least be in attendance for something as big as the Bharat Ratna?
You know, to be very honest, at that time, you know, I also defended on tweet, you know, on Twitter, they're not attending, you know, because I was very much involved in Congress politics then.
Yeah.
And I said, so many other people were, other senior leaders were there. Ahmed Patel was there. Bhupinder Hooda was there. Anand Sharma was there. So, you know, but yes, looking back, I think they should have been, you know, gracious enough to perhaps attend the ceremony.
Do you think it was a lack of grace?
I don't know why, but they should have. I think they could have at least, you know, one member they could have.
So there are many details like this, and we could be talking for hours, but one of the most, the other most compelling issues that the diaries address is Pranab Da not becoming Prime Minister. Bharat Ratna, President, the most important minister in the UPA, but never Prime Minister. And before he dies, you ask him that your unfulfilled dream, Dada, was that you didn't become Baba, rather, you called him, did not become Prime Minister. And he said he agreed that that remained an unfulfilled dream. And there are other moments also where he acknowledges that he had that desire, but he knew that Sonia Gandhi would never make him Prime Minister.
Yeah. But the last time when I talked to him a couple of months before his passing away, that whether he had any regrets of not becoming the Prime Minister, he quoted a beautiful line from Tagore. I'll first say it in Bengali. Ki paini tare hishab milate honomor nohe raji. I don't want to sit and keep an account, a ledger book of what I got and what I didn't get. You know, I am like it, he. It was a 3-4 line quote that, you know, I'm grateful and to God that for what I got. And when I also read his diaries, you know, and especially one of the entries, I think, towards the end of his presidency. So he wrote that, you know, I was a MP for so many years. I was a minister for, I think, 23 years. I was the president. You know, I bow to Lord Almighty. He was a very religious person. You know, I'm grateful to Lord Almighty for bestowing his blessings on me. So what I think that my father, of course, he had the desire to be the prime minister, but he also accepted the fact that it's not going to be. And in general, he was grateful. He was grateful to God or life or whatever you can say. He was grateful for what he got rather than being bitter about what he did not get.
But Manmohan Singh later acknowledges that Pranab Da was much more qualified to be prime minister than Manmohan Singh was. Manmohan Singh made a joke and said, I didn't have a choice.
Yeah, it's very true. That was in one of his Baba's book release ceremony. And I think this was an extremely gracious comment to be made by Dr. Manmohan Singh.
But let's go back to where this rumor started or where the mistrust started and there were rumors attached to it. Indira Gandhi has just been assassinated. Mm-hmm. Pranab Da, Rajiv Gandhi are among those who are flying back. They've heard that she's been attacked. They're rushing back to Delhi. From the cockpit comes a message that Indira is dead. She has not survived the terror attack. Or the assassination bit, rather. Pranab Da breaks into tears mid-air. From there starts a rumor that at that time, Pranab Mukherjee staked his claim as the senior most politician to be prime minister, and the Gandhi family never forgave him for that, for feeling like he too could be prime minister. Firstly, that also speaks to a kind of entitlement, but let's put that aside. Your book talks about how this was a false story.
Absolutely. You know, after my father passed away, I got some handwritten notes, which he obviously, it was meant for his memoirs. And most of it he has already written in his book, but some of the crucial details he left out as per, you know, who planted the story. So as per him, right or wrong, it was Barkat Ghani Khan Chaudhary. And Barkat actually, you know, there was a discussion in the flight that what is to be done. And Balram Jakar asked my father that, Gulzari Lal Nanda, why was he chosen? You know, so my father said that because he was the second in the cabinet, because of his rank in the cabinet.
Yeah.
Perhaps that was taken
because Pranab Da was the number two in the cabinet.
Yes, that was taken as this thing. And then Ghani Khan Chaudhary said that can an outsider, because that time Rajiv Gandhi was not part of cabinet, can an outsider become
Prime Minister?
So my father replied that yes, if the Congress Parliamentary Party chooses him as a leader, there's no problem. And then Jakar asked him to talk to Rajiv Gandhi and tell him, you know. So he went, and then all these things are in his book also, my book also. Yeah. And in fact, P.C. Alexander, you know, that time he was the principal secretary to Indiraji, and he also played a major role.
Yeah.
So he later wrote in his book that, you know, some people tried to play spread a rumor, and obviously with the intention of creating a rift between my father and Rajiv Gandhi. So I think as per my Baba, you know, that it was first planted by Chaudhary. And later on, it was taken up by people around
But that's
Rajiv.
The old story. The fact is that Sonia Gandhi counted on Pranab Mukherjee to run the government. You know, there used to be a joke on how many GOMs Pranab Da headed. But did not initially give him the ministry of his choice. He wanted home and external affairs. She did not give it to him. You chronicle that in the book. And at one point, you ask your father, why don't you go to Sonia Gandhi and argue with her, why are you not making me prime minister? And he jokes and he said, you think I'm like you. If I fight, I'll get my way. And you back off from the argument.
Yes.
But didn't you feel as a daughter that it was unfair that the troubleshooter of the government, the most experienced person, the person who defended the government in parliament, the person who was counted on in every crisis was never made the prime minister? And this, I mean, no disrespect to Dr. Manmohan Singh. you know, he has his own place in history. But did you feel that the Gandhis were really unfair in this way to your father?
As a daughter, definitely I do. As a daughter, definitely I do, you know. But I asked the same question to my father and I told him that, you know, perhaps he would have been a better prime. I didn't say perhaps. I said he would have been a better prime minister. So he said that that's your subjective way of thinking. You know, Dr. Manmohan Singh's daughter would think it very differently. You know, but that is the time he said that, you know, like in politics, in the cutthroat world of politics, everybody safeguard their own interest. And perhaps Sonia thought that making someone the prime minister with whom, towards whom she had more trust not to challenge her authority. She made the thing, she made her choice according to what suits her.
I think there's a conversation or a diary entry that takes place where you say, would you challenge your authority?
Yes, there's a conversation.
And he says, I don't know whether I would or not is not the point. She thought I would.
Yes.
So effectively, so I'll tell you a funny story. I was once interviewing Pranab Da and I asked him, you know, are you upset that you've never made it as prime minister? And of course, he couldn't tell me all these stories. So he laughed and his face turned red. And he said, you know, I can't ever be prime minister. So I said, why? He said, my Hindi is very bad.
You know? That's the excuse.
That was the excuse. But effectively, what your book reveals is that he was never made prime minister because he had a mind of his own. He was too independent.
Yes, not only he has a mind of his own, I also have a mind of his own. But I am not by his backed by his experience, his expertise and his knowledge. So it was very difficult to argue with my father. And, you know, when he was also a very assertive person.
Yeah.
He was a very assertive person.
With a quick temper. We all remember that.
Yeah. So you know, I also wrote in my book that in a very personality-centered political culture, perhaps, you know, it's easier for the supreme leaders to deal with people who are not so assertive in terms of voicing their opinion.
So he did not become prime minister because he had an assertive personality.
Assertive personality with a deadly combination of experience, expertise and knowledge. You know, he was meticulous in doing his homework. You know, his grasp over subjects was fantastic. But one thing, you know, what I have also seen and I have heard this from various people, you know, from senior people from the party, that once a decision was taken and that was a decided party line, I mean, he just absolutely strictly followed that. So I personally think that this, if this was the reason, you know, because again, this is my perspective and what I felt was Baba's perspective, my interpretation of my father's perspective.
Your perspective based on his diaries and conversations and being his daughter is that the Gandhis did not make Pranab Da the prime minister because he had an assertive personality and an independent mind.
Yes, that is what he thought in terms of, he did not write it in context of Sonia ji, but he wrote it in terms of Rajiv Gandhi, that I think the reason why he was dropped from second cabinet of Rajiv Gandhi, because Rajiv felt, and I use that I am a tough nut. And he felt that it was in our 2 months of working together, he felt that it will be difficult for him to work with.
And I guess they were never convinced that he didn't have the ambition for the top job.
Perhaps, you know, they did not trust. And in fact, a few years down the line, there is another entry in my father's diary. I don't know if you have seen that. That Shivshankar, who was a law minister during the Rajiv's time and also a cabinet minister during Rajiv's time. So he told my father and that as per him, people around Rajiv at that time, and also included some of the you know, former colleagues of my father at Indiraji's cabinet, they told Rajiv that he might become a challenge to his authority, and that was the reason why he was not.
And that feeling continued even through the Sonia years.
Yes, perhaps.
Another detail that certainly I didn't know was that Pranab Mukherjee also disagreed with Rajiv Gandhi on what we know as the Shabano case.
Yes.
Very important detail because there's a letter that you reproduce where he writes to Rajiv Gandhi and he urges him to not overturn the Supreme Court decision that is giving alimony to Muslim women.
Well, what he wrote that, you know, that this decision to overturn the Supreme Court judgment, it was not right, but at it has, for whatever reason, the government had taken this decision. So what he requested that, you know, don't issue a whip. you know, let the Congress MPs decide according to their own conscience. Don't issue a whip, you know. So, whereas, you know, Rajiv Gandhi issued a three-line whip.
That's right.
And as I read from my father's party that he voted against the bill.
So, he defied the whip.
He defied it.
That is such an interesting detail.
Yes.
Pranab Mukherjee voted against the bill that overturned the Shabano judgment. I'm endlessly fascinated, by the way, by so many of these details. Now, another big story was the visit of Pranab Da to the RSS headquarters. And you fought with him also.
Yes.
You fought with him.
Very badly.
And the Congress was calling you, Ahmed Patel was calling you, ki unko bolo mat jaye, persuade him to not go. And then he goes and he makes a speech there about constitutional patriotism. And you write in your book that you were wrong to question him. You were wrong to see it as a betrayal. And he also says to you, you said, how can you accept their principles? And he said, well, the country in a large measure is believing in them. So how can you not? So talk about that episode.
Well, what my this thing is, not the how can you accept their principle, because
you know that he ideologically opposed them, but how
absolutely.
Can you interact
but, you know,
with,
how can yeah. you interact with them? And you know, you're going, because that was the kind of argument going around in Congress circles, that by going there, you know, he is going to give legitimacy to RSS. Mm. So he got irritated with me and he said, who am I to give legitimacy to RSS? It is the people of the country, you know, who has given legitimacy to RSS by choosing one RSS Pracharak with a fantastic majority. So who am I? And, you know, he always believed in dialogue. And he said that, you know, you can only ignore the fact and at your own cost, at your own peril. So that is something, you know, I did not understand it then. Mm. And what I found later when I thought about it, look back at the entire episode, that Baba actually used the RSS platform to preach Congress ideology. Mm. So that was, I remember one, you know, beautiful tweet by somebody, I don't remember who, saying that Pranab Mukherjee is trolling RSS, you know. So actually that is something which is there, you know, and he absolutely believed that, you know, you just can't, you know, ignore some organization or some ideology just because it's opposed to yours. I mean, India is a free country, and, you know, when especially the people of the country have chosen, you know, RSS Pracharak is the prime minister. How can you just ignore it? And he always believed in dialogues, and he always felt that that is the greatest strength of democracy. That is the greatest strength of democracy.
I mean, you have to wonder where that era of politics has gone.
Yeah, exactly.
Even in our public life, you know, friendships are broken. Relationships
absolutely.
Are broken today on differences of political opinions.
Absolutely.
That takes us to, brings us rather to the Prime Minister and his relationship with the Prime Minister. And there's a lot about that relationship. And you say that ideologically they didn't agree on most things, but they, and I'm quoting you, seem to get along famously. And you write about how Prime Minister Modi would touch Pranab Da's feet every time he met him. And after one meeting, an ADC overheard Modi ji praising Pranab Da. Talk about that.
Yeah, so that, you know, he came to, after Baba became president, so he came to meet Baba. That time he was Gujarat chief minister. So he came to meet him, to invite him for some program in Gujarat. And about that meeting, Baba, there's a very interesting entry that the Gujarat CM came to meet me. He's a bitter critique of Congress and the government. And at NDC meetings, you know, we have sometimes had bitter spats. Mm-hmm. But in private, he always touches my feet and says that it gives him pleasure to do so. Mm. I don't understand the reason. I don't understand why. Mm. And then when he went with the ADC who was waiting outside the president's office to escort him out. So he told me that supposedly Mr. Modi came out from the room saying, "Kya bhavya vyaktitva hai?" So I didn't even know the meaning of the word bhavya. So I asked some you know, friend. So it means it's like what a towering personality or something like that. Kya bhavya vyaktitva hai? Kya bhavya vyaktitva hai? Simsi kept on saying that.
So, but there's also another entry where he talks about Prime Minister Modi. And he talks about, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, the Prime Minister's focus and how he found that Modi was completely in command.
Sorry, I don't follow the question.
I'm saying there was other entries also about the Prime Minister.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And his,
you know,
yeah.
This is something, you know, I found a very interesting note in his papers. And that note was not signed or not dated. And it was, it seemed to be an observation on the first cabinet meeting.
That's right.
Of the,
of
the Modi government. And there was, you know, it was written in bullet points. And so there was in this observation, so the note observed that it is quite clear that the Prime Minister is in command of the meeting from the very beginning. And also towards the you know, beginning of their interaction, there is also an entry in Baba's diary, and where they had a long discussion about something, about various things. And so he wrote that it is quite clear that he has got a very clear grasp over issues. And something like that.
Yeah, that's what I remember. Clarity and focus.
Clarity and focus.
You.
And a professional approach to governance. Yes.
That's right. You developed, and that he's very focused on good governance. I think that was, the diary entry. So look, people are going to look at this book and they're going to say, Pranab Da may have ideologically disagreed with the BJP all his life, but he was more impressed with Prime Minister Modi as a politician than he was with Rahul Gandhi.
Yeah.
Correct?
So, yes, absolutely. But so?
No, just, I mean, stating
absolutely,
what comes out of the book.
Absolutely, yes, totally, of course. And he I mean, told me many times, and also he has written in his diaries, he felt that after Indira Gandhi, I mean, he has never seen another prime minister having such a you know, hold over, such an understanding of people's pulse, you know, like he can read people's pulse, you know. Mm. So that's obviously a great quality for a politician.
How do you think the Congress is going to react? You've left politics.
Well, I mean, of course, you know, I mean, no senior leader has reacted anything, but the Congress trolls are already. So I'm scared to, you know, go through my, you know, I mean, I'm not,
your
not
timeline.
Seeing, not seeing the response on my Twitter.
Well, certain things are predictable, but like I said, it couldn't help the Congress right now. But it's the fact that your book clearly says that the Prime Minister, as you said, was someone Pranab Da had professional respect for.
Yes.
As a politician. And Rahul Gandhi is somebody he was livid and disillusioned with by the end of his life. And that disillusionment extended to the family, not just to Rahul Gandhi. I want you to talk about your own relationship with the Prime Minister that develops and stays. And that's quite interesting. That you will go and meet the Prime Minister.
That's hardly any relationship.
I mean,
I paid a few courtesy call, and he had always been very.
And you told him, "Can you teach me how to win elections?"
Yes, yes. I asked him. It was immediately after the corporation election in Delhi, and I think BJP, despite, you know, being in power for two terms, you know, again, one with a thumping majority. So I just jokingly asked him that, "Sir, can you please teach me how to win elections?" So he just laughed and said, "Come and meet me sometime." So anyway, I went and met him without realizing that he's actually going to give me an appointment. And then, you know, we had a very interesting discussion. And what I found the most interesting thing about him, that, you know, he was never very dismissive about things, never got angry. My father used to get very dismissive about, you know, you I think probably know, and many journalists.
We've all been shouted at my brother at some
point
in our lives.
You know, if he thinks that, you know, you haven't done your
homework. Sabko dan piti, sabko.
Yeah, done your, and I have got, you know, so many.
Even including, have you come without doing your homework?
Yes,
not,
yes,
all that.
Yes, yes, but all I have that. To say, whatever my little interaction with Mr. Modi has been, and I asked him different question, including attitude towards minority, including when are they going to get women's reservation bill on triple talaq and some other things. So he was never evasive. Obviously, he gave very politically correct answer, naturally. But he was never evasive, never got angry with, and you know, I also very politely, you know, kind of expressed my disagreement with him on certain issues.
Yeah.
But I mean, that I really found it amazing that he never lost his cool or never evasive or dismissive about it.
Well, he had a soft corner for your father. And one of your father's diary entries says that Modi has a soft corner for me.
Yes, yes. And I think that is a reason, obviously, you know, because I got the appointments with him, not because I was some hotshot journalist. I was not Barkha. I was not.
I don't get appointments with Prime Minister Modi.
I was not a big politician, but simply because I was my father's daughter. As simple as that.
This conversation would not be complete in the last few minutes without talking about Mamata Banerjee, right? There's a lot about Mamata, including her initially opposing Pranab for president, then coming around. And it seems to be, I don't want to use the word love-hate, but it seems to be an up-and-down sort of relationship. How do you look at that and how do you think he saw her?
Yes, it was absolutely a up-and-down kind of a relationship. And I think she's one person, I just could not fathom her reasons. I still could not understand that, you know, why he opposed Baba's candidature for presidency. And I just could not understand that. What was the political reason behind it?
Yeah.
You know, and considering that she was part of UPA, considering that, you know, Baba was the first Bengali presidential candidate. So I still could not understand the reason behind it. And of course, you know, when I asked Baba, Baba said that she, you know, she's very erratic, but she's going to support me at the end. He was very confident
about
that.
How would you describe their equation?
Stormy.
Interesting. Now, there's so much to talk about. You talk about demonetization. You talk about retrospective tax, which was probably his most controversial decision. There's so much in the book and we could talk for hours. But let me end this conversation by asking you. When you look back at your father's life, what do you think was his most difficult phase politically when you saw him really troubled?
After Rajiv Gandhi, when Rajiv Gandhi dropped him from the cabinet, and then after some time, you know, he was expelled from the party. I think that was politically the most difficult period for him.
And he never became bitter?
Not really. You know, I think he had this tremendous ability, you know, and perhaps that is why I think that the writing, you know, the new age mantra of writing down your feelings, it perhaps has
was cathartic.
So he never, you know, I mean, probably I'm sure at that time he must have felt very angry and very, very this thing. But then whenever I talked with him or the subsequent, you know, reading of his diaries, I never felt a bitterness.
How many diaries are there?
I think about 51. About 51. In between, some of the diaries were lost because of some flooding in our basement. Yeah. And he stopped writing for a while. But then P.V. Narasimha Rao told him that, you know, you have to resume it because maybe
I'm glad you mentioned Narasimha Rao because one thing I want to ask you.
Yes.
He said that, you know, the Gandhis didn't come for Bharat Ratna, but they didn't even allow Narasimha Rao's body. This is the story you tell to come into the Congress headquarters. He kept his relationship with Narasimha Rao.
Yes. Yes.
Despite advisors, well-wishers saying, don't do this, the Gandhis will disapprove.
Yes, yes.
Talk about that.
And in fact, I found a paper in my mother's papers that my mother actually stood security for Narasimha Rao when he was first arrested, then released on bail. And as per my father's diaries, he was asked by Mr. Potedar, who conveyed a message supposedly from 10 Janpath that don't attend his CBI hearing case. I mean, indirectly saying that don't keep any, you know, keep in touch. But of course, I mean, I don't know whether Baba attended the CBI hearing or not. But I know this much that my mother stood security for him. And he was the one, I mean, he was one of the very few congressmen, you know, who actually kept in touch with Narasimha Rao regularly.
What is your, in conclusion, relationship today with the Gandhi family? And if there is one, do you think it will remain after this book?
I don't think, you know, I mean, firstly, I was very junior in the party hierarchy to have any relationship with the Gandhis. I mean, I just met them a couple of times, that too, with the people, or maybe a couple of times, courtesy call. But I definitely plan to send a book to Sonia ji.
You do?
Yes, of course. Because
she's not going to like a lot of what's in here.
She might not like a lot, and she's within her rights and not to, you know, like or to agree. But I think there will be certain things which might also bring a smile to her face, you know.
Yeah. So. Life is a mixed bag. The book is, because it's somebody's written diaries, it's extraordinarily candid and detailed. And like I said, we could talk for hours, but we'll say thank you right now. Once again, this is Sharmistha Mukherjee's book, Pranab, my father, it takes you inside explosive 51 diaries. It paints an absolutely scathing portrayal of the Gandhi family, of Rahul Gandhi. The Gandhi family is described as having the worst sort of hegemony over the party. But there's a lot more as well. This spans several decades of politics. It's a slice of India's contemporary history, and it's an absolute must read. Thank you for writing it, and thank you for talking to us.
Thank you, Barkha.
Thank you. Mojo's Story has always made a commitment to its viewers to go to where the story is. And as you can see here, we are at the epicenter of the Israel war on Gaza. We are right at the front line, about 1 mile from the Gaza Strip, as the Israeli military gets ready with its tanks and its gunners to begin its final frontal assault that will take troops into Gaza. As we said, we are not like other organizations. We believe in giving you all sides of the story objectively and as much as possible from the ground. And that's exactly what we're doing here, covering the biggest global story today from the epicenter of the war zone. So please, we need your support. Support us, become a Mojo member, subscribe to us, spread the word, and thank you for your support.